The world is different in 1989. The first Columbo opened with a fake shooting, a long-distance phone call, and a real shooting. The show returns with long-distance extrasensory perception, a fake shooting, and a real beheading. The faded 70s elegance is gone. The gleaming high-tech of the 80s is here, baby. And it's as radical as you imagined. Yes, it's our first look at the new Columbo. The Columbo we'll be with till the end of his history and... there we go. Reviving the lieutenant for a new generation of fans, today's Echoes is a history maker in more ways than one, setting the tone for the 23 adventures to follow. Columbo goes to the guillotine. Black screen, white titles, the psychic testing room, Anthony Zerbe, the fog, Dyson's test with the fax machines, the workshop, the murder, the car and the cigar, and Columbo's whole intro. These opening scenes have so much promise, and then... But everything before is so darn good, so distinctive, these scenes could only be from Guillotine. Afterward, the supporting characters mostly disappear and there are lengthy scenes of Elliot Blake and Columbo talking. Can you imagine scenes going on this long today? Amidst these walls of dialogue, the episode loses its way, dwelling on minute clues.
That's a Phillips head screw. That's a completely different kind of screw.
And missing all the Cold War secret agent stuff they built up before. Things turn around again when we return to the psychic testing room for Columbo's performance, and some actual tension as they stalk each other around the guillotine. The inconsistency in tone is even reflected in the score by John Kakavas. His initial moody, mysterious themes quickly give way to a carnival-like fanfare for the lieutenant himself, and that music dominates the later portions of the score. One comes away wishing the mood of these early scenes could have been sustained better. Leo Penn, fresh off the Conspirators 11 years ago, gives us this cool 360-degree opening shot to kick things off, but afterwards restrains himself to TV-friendly medium shots and over-the-shoulder volleys. The cinematic sweep that marks the best episodes is missing. Anthony Andrews does fine as Elliot Blake, nailing the classic, annoyed when his back is turned, smiling when he turns around thing. He and Falk have great on-screen chemistry.
Please, Lieutenant.
Generating a level of faux congeniality that almost rivals Murder Under Glass. In our exploration of Murder, Smoke, and Shadows, I said that Fisher Stevens should have repeated as a killer, and I'd have given the more suave, classical Andrews a shot, too. Elliot Blake is also one of an elite group of killers, those who attempt to kill Columbo in the same fashion as their previous victim, giving themselves away in the process. This trope is solely the domain of producer Richard Allen Simmons, with three of his 11 produced episodes ending this way. Guillotine occupies an interesting niche in the show's history by being one of the very, very few Columbo holiday specials. In this case, we know the date.
It is Monday, March 14th.
Although there is no Monday, March 14th in 1989. So maybe this is a subtle hint that the revival shows exist in a different reality. But that date, and the fact that Max Dyson bought corned beef and cabbage, means that we are closing in on St. Patrick's Day. You'd think the Conspirators would have been a St. Patrick's Day special, right? But like the Conspirators, Guillotine is one of those double mysteries. Not so much about Dyson's murder, but how did Blake beat the psychic test? Which, interestingly, was what Dyson himself was hired to do. Look for other parallels between victim and detective. The wonky eyes, the askew ties, the use of Mr.
Ready, Mr. Blake? Mr. Blake?
Mr. Blake?
Mr. Blake?
Mr. Blake?
Mr. Blake?
Speaking of Max Dyson, everyone else sees the subtext here, right?
April Fool, Paula!
Anthony Zerbe plays him in very camp fashion.
We'll try some, distant viewing.
You cannot miss it. The implication is that Dyson and Blake were more than just friends in that Ugandan prison.
What we meant to each other in that place, what we gave each other.
Blake even cries at his funeral.
There are those here who loved him.
The Columbo solving the magician's tricks angle is where we see an obvious parallel to the series' other magic-themed episode, where a lot of solving the case is breaking Santini's illusionary alibi. Also, Columbo gets scared by a miniature guillotine, which happens to him again here, and Blake wears a pinky ring just like Santini does, and neither man uses his real name.
Could you at least tell me which name it was?
When did you change your name?
And Columbo says this.
It certainly was a murder, sir.
Like in Grand Deceptions.
It certainly was a murder, sir.
And the bartender's an ex-cop, like in Identity Crisis. And Harrow was Riley Greenleaf's lawyer and Coop's dad. Columbo says this. Like in Grand Deceptions.
To the guillotine, to the window.
And Sex and the Married Detective.
To the therapy room.
And he says vibrations.
Vibrations.
The vibrations?
Vibrations!
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 Murder by the Book set the tone for the early episodes and goes to the guillotine, or is it guillotine?
Suicide with a guillotine.
Does the same for the revival shows. This is basically what we'll get, which is the essential job of any first episode. If you thought the shrewd, squinting cop Columbo was going to make a return, you now know that we're in the era of wide-eyed grandpa Columbo. Could Peter Falk play things any broader here? How many hand gestures in a row is too many? Why does he keep saying some?
That's some terrific name for a baby.
That must be some dangerous trick.
I would make some wonderful detective.
This St. Patrick's Day, slice up some cabbage, stock up on the corned beef, and give Columbo Goes to the Guillotine a watch. Not the worst.
True.
Not the best. I'd give it a solid C.
You and I agree to 86%.
All right, maybe a B.
But it isn't true.
Well, it's somewhere in there.
~120 degrees in the shade, or an afternoon of poker in a Ugandan prison.